It is indeed an honor to be here with you this morning, receiving the Lifetime Achievement Award. Roger will be the next year's plenary speaker, and many others before me have been recognized. This is our society. We built it 20 years ago. Some of us took risks as young researchers in this field, going into the with the risk of the unknown into this new area, and now the rewards are coming later on. I would like to, as I go through my presentation, first to mention that for the past 20 years, as Chris also mentioned, I'm at Texas A&M, which is a big public university, about 50,000 students, on flat land in Texas, in the heart of Texas. And most of the work that I will be describing to you today took place in the Department of Aerospace Engineering. A&M, Texas A&M, is a university with traditions which go back to 100 plus years. There is this long tradition of leadership and service instilled to the student body by the Corps of Cadets. There is the bonfire tradition for many years. And trying to look into the historical archives and find the connection between Texas A&M and Safe Memory Alloys, I realized that the name Texas A&M means transformation from austenite to martensite. And the bonfire is used to provide the thermal energy needed for that. To further prove you that this is correct, at every football game, there is the Aki band, very famous, that goes through this reversible formation from austenite into martensite. So this is the place where I have been working for the past 20 years. And when I look back into my story, it is basically a Greek in Texas trying to fit into an environment by adopting the traditions and the living style. And I have been very privileged to be part of that environment. I just want to understand also why in Texas, and then going through some of the old pictures, this is as a young individual trying to show strength. But this is an event that is like the Mardi Gras, the annual event before Easter. And even though everybody was dressed with a traditional Greek costume, then I was dressed like a cowboy. This is the graduation ceremony when I received my undergraduate degree, and then moved to Lehigh University for my graduate degree. And I'm very privileged to have great mentors. My love for continuum mechanics and thermodynamics came from my advisor, Professor Idelen. This is a conversation in Texas with Professor Eringen, both contributing to thermodynamics and continuum mechanics in the past several decades, from 60s to 80s. And of course, there are many people who helped. I want to single out one in particular who is not as recognized in this community, and this is Professor Iraz Tasbas. Some of you may have met him. He was in the mechanics community in the 50s, and I met him at RPI, where I spent about 4 years as an assistant professor. He spent his sabbatical at ARO with Gary Anderson, and this is what started the major initiatives in the late 80s. We had three major multi-university research initiatives. We wrote one proposal with Professor Tasbas at RPI. There was with Inderjit Chopra at Maryland and Rogers at Virginia Tech. Unfortunately, he passed away, but he has been one of the early promoters of smart structures. I was also blessed with great colleagues across the world, but this particular picture indicates In the early 90s, a meeting of the Defense Science Study Group, I was in that group, and some of you may recognize some, this is where I am, much younger, but you can recognize some other faces who have been part of this community. Kate Brinson, for example, is in the forefront, another contributor to Safe Memory Alloy Constitutive Modeling. And also, I'm blessed with great collaborators from different government agencies, industry. This is the inaugural meeting of CASMART, and this picture is a Texas A&M in Karaman's laboratory with collaborators from Boeing, NASA, and a few other places. And of course, above all, the students who contributed over the years and what we have done is built as PhD thesis and postdoctoral activities of many of our students in the past 20 years. And I will give credit to individuals at the end of my presentation. And I would like, before I go into the technical part of my presentation, to acknowledge my family, my wife, my two daughters, and my son-in-law. And I'm proud that we're a family of engineers, aerospace, mechanical, biomedical engineers, and that gives me hope that the future will be okay. In the presentation, I would like to first give an overview and some historical perspectives on SMAs, then focus in one slice of our work on constitutive modeling of SMAs and some of the challenges, the current and the future challenges for safe memory alloys. I want to ask, I hear the echo. Should I do something with my microphone? Are you hearing well in the back? Yes? Okay. For the overview, I will focus on safe memory alloys as actuators and a few examples of other materials, but mostly the actuation characteristics of SMAs. And if you see from the first application, the discovery of nitinol, the nickel titanium SMA in the Naval Ordnance Laboratory in the early 60s, there are many applications, at least in the US, with hydraulic couplers for the aerospace industry, for the nuclear industry, latches, release devices for the space industry, and the early biomedical devices. New developments of materials, especially with ternary alloys, by putting beyond the copper-based alloys, we had the nickel titanium, now we see some other materials being developed for high temperatures applications. And this is just a few examples in the US. There were many other centers around the world, in Japan, in the former Soviet Union at that time, and European countries. A few examples that stand out in my mind is the Smart Wing program at Northrop Grumman, where we saw the excitement of trying to incorporate a torque tube-shaped memory alloy actuator to morph the wing of that small, it was like a UCAV, a UAV, scaled-down version of a fighter. It was the first time we realized the capability of SMAs, but also the challenges in controlling the actuation, in stress concentration, in fatigue, many of these issues, and power consumption came to life. Then later on, late 90s, early 2000, the 21st century, we see prototypes being tested. The Samson program by Boeing, funded by DARPA, I believe, was a key full-scale testing in the NASA Langley Wind Tunnel, showing the ability of SMA actuators to change internal flows in a big-scale structure. And then I would say the past 10 years, there was a low in our community on safe memory alloys, where the question is, what do we do next? The aerospace industry was reconfiguring to mostly going into applications where smaller scale systems were tested, but other sectors of the economy entered, for example, the oil and gas industry, facing challenges in solid state actuators at higher depths, considered high temperature SMAs. And I think that revived, at least in the US, and specifically in Texas, our interest in safe memory alloys. The timeline for Boeing, you see from, and this is for the aerospace industry, but this slide I took from Todd Calkins at Boeing. You see, going from large-scale systems like the variable geometry chevron into parts of the engine or the advanced wing. They have a program now, the clean wing program, where they take a Boeing 737 wing and they try not to morph the whole wing, but go into sections, embedding actuators, and changing the aerodynamics for fuel efficiency. And this seems to be the trend, more integrating SMAs or actuators in smart system subcomponents. This is a composite slide that just shows the breadth of the applications of safe memory alloys, either as conventional NITI, nickel titanium alloys, or iron-based, cost-effective SMAs or high-temperature safe memory alloys, into the different applications in jet engine technology, into space foldable solar array structures, potential for transmission lines, controlling stability of their length and vibrations, to devices for the oil and gas industry, to automotive. This SMA engine by GM started recently, energy harvesting with wind turbines, and also stability of cables in offshore drilling. There is a menu of applications that there are many prototypes, and some have been implemented into different industrial products. And this is an indication that the field is mature and is developing. As I mentioned, I will focus mostly on SMAs as actuators. And I want to mention that this behavior of SMAs that we usually have, which is stress-strain response at a temperature usually above the austenitic finish, produces this nonlinear hysteretic response that has the capacity for attenuation of vibrations, for energy absorption, but also this is mostly what is used in biomedical devices. However, this is not the actuation function that we get from SMAs. This is described in the phase diagram, the stress temperature diagram, that shows where austenite is stable, where martensite is stable. In a line, as indicated by this simple experiment here, where under stress, which is the load hanging on an SMA spring, we change the temperature here by joule heating. And then at some point, the martensite, as we raise the temperature, phase becomes unstable, goes into austenite. And by doing this, you have this transformation strain that is released in the material, providing the actuation. So the load normalized by the area, the stress, times the relative deformation is what gives us the actuation stress, the capacity for actuation for the material. And for SMAs, it is quite high. So what I will concentrate mostly describing for you today is this type of behavior, the behavior of safe memory alloys as we go through temperature variations under loads where they function as actuators. And in this space of actuation space where you put the actuation stress, that weight hanging versus relative deformation, the actuation strain, and the product, of course, are these work energy density. You see that shape memory alloys are at the high end, high stress, more than 100 megapascal, relatively high deformations, about 1%. And of course, most of us know that the limitation is the frequency response. Compared, let's say, to piezo ceramics, where you have high frequency but smaller strains. And in this space, I think the technology of developing materials will move, producing materials as high in that corner as possible with high frequency response characteristics. And the magnetic SMAs, for example, have been developed exactly for that reason. I will not describe them today, but it is for the last decade, 15 years, focus for many applications and development of materials because their blocking stress is relatively low. And of course, the safe memory polymers that can have high deformation characteristics, 100% strain, have been used more and more for biomedical applications, even though their actuation strain energy is relatively small due to the relatively small blocking stress. And just to give you an example, this also could be a shape memory alloy. This is a filter, a shape memory polymer filter. This is not an animation, this is an actual simulation where we put the SMA polymer constitutive model into a finite element implementation. You pull it into the catheter, then you deploy, and then the warmth of the body deploys the filter that then cleans the blood. So some of these applications are developed with the biomedical engineering department at Texas A&M. This is a few remarks about shape memory alloys and their use as actuators. Now I want to go and give you a few steps into the logic behind what we have done the past 20 years in developing the shape memory alloy constitutive response. And in my mind, I was thinking how to present it. The best way that I can rationalize is that after you realize that the phase transformation is responsible for this large strain, you have to couple this with a thermomechanical response, of the thermoelastic response of the material. Then you have to train the material. You have to account for transformation-induced plasticity. Then you have to embed, integrate this SMA actuator into a structure. You deal with large stresses, concentrations. You have to include plasticity. And then at the end, you have to do either the shape setting at high temperatures or use high temperature SMAs. So viscoplasticity and transformation have to be coupled. This is the logic, and we have developed modeling and others as well over the years, and applications into SMA composites. And at the end, the holy grail of developing of actuators is fracture and fatigue. I will say a few things about this as well. Again, the motivation of why do we need models at all is that we want to abandon the legacy of design an actuator, build a system, in this case, the variable geometry Chevron, test and then iterate with all these different designs. Do we embed the actuators in parallel or in different angles to achieve a certain optimal response of the structure? We want to go from this very time-consuming and costly effort into developing a constitutive model. We characterize the material now, and then we analyze the structure using this, in this case, the finite element method, the computational analysis, and you do the design optimization in a computational environment. That is basically the motivation behind all of these developments in the constitutive modeling. So they are three-dimensional, they can embed it in a computational environment for the analysis of a real structure. And we had to make a choice early on. Do we follow the micromechanical approach? And I would single out, there are many who contribute, but Etienne Patour in France, perhaps, is the one who spent many of his years developing this approach, where you account for transformation at the single crystal, then you do the polycrystalline response, and then you average the effective medium response. It is better suited for developing processing parameters, developing new alloys, and how to optimize their behavior. However, it's not easy to integrate this into a computational environment to analyze a structure. That was a choice we made, and we followed the phenomenological approach where we introduce internal variables, sometimes not well connected with the microstructure, but give us a way of identifying the main characteristics of the nonlinear hysteretic response, and then using a thermodynamics framework to predict the constitutive response. This is the area where we focused most of our work over the past 20 years. And I just give you a few others. I'm sorry, some of you may not see your name. There are hundreds of papers in the literature. I would say the early work by Tanaka, and then later on, the implementation of some of these ideas by Rogers, Brinson, and others, developed the field, at least with the key ideas. And several of us tried to take them into a framework of thermodynamics and three-dimensional thermomechanical behavior. The complexity, again, as I mentioned to you, comes from the fact that the behavior is nonlinear and hysteretic. As an actuator, you have these hysteresis loops. Sometimes they don't close because you have transformation-induced plasticity, and sometimes the stress-strain loops do not close because you have plasticity into the system. So those are the things we try to capture with our models. The approach following established continuum mechanics, extending basically thermoelasticity, where you have a free energy function that tells you the state of the material. In this case, it's just a quadratic, where S is the compliance, sigma squared times the compliance, and then you have the coupling with the thermal expansion. And its derivative, the derivative of this function with respect to stress, gives you the strain. And you have the Hooke's law in this case for the thermoelastic material. And you can include higher order terms, so you can account for nonlinear response, if you want. When we go into SMAs, it is not just the nonlinearity that is important. It is the fact that you have a path dependence. You go, and as you apply stress strain at a given temperature, you go into one path, nonlinear response, you upload into a different path. And the same thing if you do the same experiment at a given load, changing the temperature. The strain has a hysteresis loop, this path dependence. You can only capture if you introduce internal state variables in your free energy, and then have the evolution of those defined in a proper way. So we introduced internal variables in addition to stress and temperature, which account for the degree of phase transformation. This is the volume fraction, xi is the volume fraction of martensite. And epsilon transformation are the inelastic strains that are recoverable as we go through the transformation. And again, the idea, if you want to have history dependence, but not rate dependence, is to introduce a conjugate force to this volume fraction of martensite, the thermodynamic driving force that initiates the transformation back and forth. And then you do it in a way that even though you dissipate entropy, you never violate the second law of thermodynamics. So with that framework, basically, you develop evolution equations for the volume fraction of martensite, then the transformation strain, and then you do this in a way that if you are within the thermoelastic domain, no transformation takes place. If you are outside, you have transformation. Actually, you never leave the transformation surface. You move the transformation surface with you. So this is the idea. We extended basically the formulation of plasticity now into transformation, where the transformation strains are recoverable. So you can form them, and then you absorb them as you go through the thermomechanical loading paths. That was the first level of developing the constitutive models. That was published in the early 90s with Jim Boyd, one of the key papers we published at that time. Then we tried to understand how we train SMA actuators. And some of you, when you see this, you understand what the problem is. In every cycle, you have a small stress, 35 megapascal, which is not very high for SMAs. But yet, as you go through the transformations, you change the temperature. This is the temperature scale and the strain. As you go through the transformation cycles, there is a ratcheting effect. Some strain is not recoverable. And this cannot be pure plasticity because you operate at a stress level below the yield limit for the material. So this is due to incompatibilities. It is transformation-induced plasticity. And that's where we spend, Bo Zong and other students in my group have done work by introducing the transformation-induced plasticity tensor and evolution with a number of cycles to stabilize the response of SMA actuators. The next level is when you embed these actuators after you train them, you have to bolt them, you have to connect them, you have to have cutouts. As you integrate them into the chevron, you have to make them transfer load to the structure. That means you have stress concentrations. And you reach the point where you exceed the yield stress for the material, therefore you have to account for plastic yielding and how it interacts with transformation strain. And this is true also for other devices, especially the stents that have many V points. To do this, you have to go back into the phase diagram where you have austenite, martensite, but also you have a zone at high stresses that you have plastic yield if it is above the MD temperature, but also you have a zone where both phenomena take place simultaneously. This is what we try to do, and again you see the theme, the same framework of thermodynamics, but now we introduce plastic strains as another set of internal variables. And now you do not only have the transformation surfaces, you have the yield surfaces as well. And this is an illustration that I like. Darren Hartle did his PhD thesis on that. And you have the phase diagram is just one component of stress versus temperature. And those lines, if you invert it as temperature in the vertical, stress in the horizontal, and you put another stress component, not just sigma 1-1, but sigma 2-2, then this line becomes a surface. And temperature is the vertical axis. The yield surface is a cylinder. We assume it is not a function of temperature at these low temperatures. However, the transformation surface is a function of temperature because of the phase diagram. The stress transformation is coupled. Temperature and stress are highly coupled. And then if you load the material, you see you apply uniaxial tension. This is the loading point. You yield the material, but then at some point, you start transforming the material as well. And the transformation surface start interacting with the yield surfaces. So this is something that took us years to understand and extend the constitutive models to account for this phenomenon. And all of this implemented into problems like this, where we modeled the Chevron response with three beam actuators, accounting for the stress concentrations, plasticity if we needed, and this is for the stable behavior of the SMA actuators. And this behavior has been correlated with experiments that it is quite accurate, the prediction of the shape. This is the center line of this VGC. One more, and I will be finishing with the constitutive modeling. There are two issues. As you go to higher temperatures, you start bringing rate-dependent effects. And this is not only true when you operate a structure, if you go into the hotter parts, but also when you do the thermal setting at the high temperature of a shape memory alloy. This is true for cardiovascular stents. This is an example that maybe the last 5-6 years when we started conducting experiments, we realized it is a real problem. You take the actuator at a high temperature. In this case, it is a high temperature SMA, 500 degrees Celsius. You load the material, and then you go through an actuation cycle. And then if you do the experiment at a temperature which is varying from 500 to about 300 at a very low rate, this is 2 degrees Celsius per minute. That will take several hours to do this experiment. You see that the loop not only doesn't close, but it's very different for the fast experiment where you do the actuation cycle 10 times faster, 20 degrees Celsius per minute. And we went into the modeling. We introduced now a rate-dependent model where we have viscoplastic strains as the additional internal variables and evolution equations for them that depend on time. And I'll just show you a demonstration of a uniaxial experiment here. We just, this dog bone specimen, we apply load, and we do it using the low cooling at heating rate, so it will take a few hours for this experiment to be conducted. And you see, as you cool it down, you develop transformation strain. This is about 6% strain. When you raise the temperature, because you do it slowly, you develop viscoplastic strains, and then by the end of this actuation cycle that took a few hours, basically you lost all of your transformation strain has been offset by the viscoplastic strain. So you have a 100% ineffective SMA actuator. And one has to be careful with applications of high temperature for long duration application of load. And the same thing happens for the shape setting. When you do the shape setting of the stent, this is one ring of the stent, a cardiovascular stent to be exact here, at a high temperature. And as you do this, you relax the stresses at the V points, the stress concentration points. And then when you operate the stent at lower temperatures, you don't have any stress concentration points and the fatigue life increases. This now framework of modeling we have introduced not only into structural applications, but also in composites. The recent one is we want to try to increase the fracture toughness of ceramic matrix shaped memory alloys, alloy composites, which are used for, to be used for hypersonic vehicles, for thermal burial coatings, and heat shields. And I will just show you, by using that phase transformation, the actuation characteristics of the SMA, how you can take a composite and do a thermomechanical loading path, applying load, then cooling down, transforming the SMA part of the composite, then raising the temperature and unloading. And here what you see is the stress profile for the ceramic matrix. You have this transfer of stresses from the SMA to the ceramic, and by the end of this thermal processing step, you end up having compressive stresses in the ceramic matrix, thereby increasing the effective toughness of the composite. So this is what you can do with the SMA behavior if you understand and how it interacts with its surroundings, either a structure or a composite, in this case a ceramic matrix composite. And of course this you can do because some of the new ceramics, the max phase ceramics, have this large deformation twinning detwinning capabilities as well. And of course, as I mentioned before, when you deal with actuators, at some point, fracture and fatigue becomes the big issue. Here, it is not the high cycle fatigue, it is the transformation-induced actuation fatigue, where you have an actuator under load. This is the actuator, the specimen. And then you have to test it under multiple cycles. We have a vortex cooling device here. We build with the help of Boeing. And we have been testing SMA actuators for years now. And what you get is a picture like this. You have results that cover the whole stress temperature space, but if you can put them under a plot where you put the stress times the actuation strain, so you can capture both partial and complete transformations into this work density axis, versus number of cycles, it seems like there is a master curve that you can build where you can embed partial and full transformation and different levels of stress. And indeed, you can see if you try to get too much actuation energy, either high stress or high strain, the material may only go to 10,000 actuation cycles, while they can go to 100,000, even more, as your actuation strain energy is reduced. So, this is one thing that one learns with actuation and fatigue of SMA actuators. But then if you try to go into a predictive modeling, at the end you will go back to having to understand how a crack grows into an SMA, a fatigue crack in this case. And you see two types of cracks, either developing on the surface of the actuator. This is a specimen tested. It is copper-based, small hysteresis, nickel titanium, and after this is at failure, so probably this has gone thousands of cycles before it broke. You see cracks developing at the surface due to surface defects and also incompatibilities in the transformation strain. And some eventually propagate and they fail the specimen. But also you see many micro cracks that grow within the specimen due to stress concentration sites, mostly precipitates. And this is what we focused the recent years. Here, the key motivation, other, we knew the problem, but the observations, this is from Egler's group, due to neutron diffraction, and also micro digital image correlation methods, we can understand that at the crack tip, we have transformation fronts, stress-induced martensite fronts that look like plastic strain fronts, and they are responsible for the behavior of SMAs. And just to show you one example here. If you try to grow a crack in an SMA, blue means it is an austenitic phase, and you apply load, this is a compact tension specimen, you develop these butterfly domains are volume fraction of martensite. Red means 100% martensite. And as you grow the crack, you leave behind the wake of the crack. You have, because of stress unloading, you have remnant martensite and a lot of dissipated energy. And for these cases, if you do the thermomechanical loading path properly, you can increase the fracture toughness by a factor of 2 to 3 with respect to just growing a crack into austenite or martensite. This type of understanding of crack growth in the material probably has to be continued to connect fracture and fatigue for SMAs. And now I want to spend a few minutes. I have about 10 more minutes, Chris. 5 minutes? Okay. I want to say a few things about these problems with the framework of constitutive behavior. How can we move them forward, and what are the challenges for SMAs? And I see this multi-scale approach as one, and then size effects as the second. And the upscaling has to be including a multi-physics environment together with design and optimization. This is a slide I took from some brainstorming we had with Patrus group. Etienne put it together. And when I see the slide, I realize that there are quite a few people who understand the crystalline structure of SMAs, and they understand also how dislocations interact with them, point effects, and so on. There are groups that have developed the behavior, especially the micromechanics approach for SMAs, where the size of the grain, the interaction of the grain boundary with the variants of martensite, have understood to some extent. And then you move into the polycrystalline. There are groups working on that, understanding the behavior of cyclic effect, multi-axial loading, and so on. And there are people working on the device level, where the environment now and the boundary conditions are very important. Closing this loop is going to take some effort, but I think it is necessary to be done. And we have both experimental tools and computational tools at our disposal. It is not easy. I will just mention one example here. If you try to go into microstructure, it is not just analyzing the precipitate interaction with the metrics. You have to realize that for SMAs, the behavior depends on the content of nickel. And if you have a precipitate, you already depleted either nickel or titanium, depending on the precipitate, from the surrounding zone. So diffusion of atoms has to be taken into account. That changes the transformation behavior of the surrounding medium. And then the effective response of that composite at that level is different. One with precipitates, without precipitates, just pure SMA. And then when you put the precipitates, the red one, you have a transformation that is more gradual, because you have basically developed a heterogeneous medium outside of the precipitate. So this is not going to be easy to integrate all the scales and capture the essential elements at every scale, but it is necessary, and as I said, we have the tools. Doing the fracture mechanics of SMAs into a real polycrystalline specimen has challenges, anisotropy, dynamic crack growth. And then, of course, you have to understand failure criteria for single crystal and polycrystalline materials as well. And then as you go into smaller scale, already there are experiments and modeling that shows that there is a size effect, especially this is a micro pillar, especially when the size, the diameter of the pillar becomes about the same as the length scales that you have internally, let's say the grain size or even the size of the martensitic variants. So those length scales are coupled, and you have size effects that are addressed and should be addressed by the community by different methods. The models that I presented is just one snapshot. There are other ideas, again, how to connect the micromechanical models, but also one can continue on these phenomenological models, but in a different way, perhaps going into non-local theories. And one easy way is to include the gradients of the internal variables into the free energy. Another one is to go into the integral approach, where what it happens at one point depends not only at the constitutive response of the material point there, but in a surrounding area. Again, these are old ideas. Nowadays, peridynamics, for example, is a discipline that tries to capture that. So this is something that I see in the future be done at a larger scale, more efforts there. And as we go into the larger scale modeling, new ideas with other disciplines, this is now design, origami-based design, combined with the ability of SMAs to change form locally when we control the temperature. And this can be done for homogeneous SMA films, or they can be done for SMA composites, let's say elastomeric matrix composites. And here, to show you, this is an animation where, this is a simulation, it's not an animation, where we can fold a 3D cube by controlling the temperature locally of the same memory alloy material. Again, it is a full simulation using Abacus with a constitutive model, and the temperature and the deformations are exact. And also we can simulate, again, from the cartoon to the realistic simulation, this working, I mean, these ideas, the inchworm actuators and so on, are very old ideas in our community. But now we can simulate, using this thermomechanically coupled environment, the actual folding and unfolding of this working bifold, and then you can even do it all the way to falling off the cliff when the friction is not enough for it to keep working. And the challenge there, I think, is to integrate with the structural response that I think we are successfully implementing, the actuation response that I believe we're mostly okay with embedding the actuation into the structural response, the environment, which is the boundary condition. In this case, this is a small SMA plate. Small variation in that changes the flow field enormously, and vice versa. The flow field will change the boundary conditions. So the fluid solid or fluid structure interaction environment is not here yet and needs to be further developed. The future of shape memory materials, I think they will continue to be multi-purpose. We use different words, adaptive, active, smart, multifunctional, meta, and we will keep using these words, I think. Polymaterials, because we have not only metals, intermetallics, we have polymers, and now I see ceramics in that category of shape memory materials. They will continue to be part of a materials design methodology. For example, in the materials genome initiatives, I have seen multifunctional materials to be in the core of developing new metamaterials. And I think the focus there will be the coupling of the fields, thermal to mechanical, mechanical to magnetic, but also the efficiency of the conversion as we develop new materials. And they will keep being integrated into the design, the analysis, and the optimization of the functionality of the engineering systems, from aerospace to automotive, the electronics, the energy sector, and they will continue to be what we now call multiphysics, different mechanical, thermal, electromagnetism, multi-scale to account for the different phenomena at the different scales, and multidisciplinary, combining different disciplines, the mechanical with aerospace, with architectural, with the design discipline. I would like at this point to acknowledge the many collaborators, some of the current groups of the SMART team, especially Darren Hartle, who has stayed at A&M, continuing with some of the activities we're doing there on shape memory alloys, collaborators like Ibrahim Karaman, Etienne Batur, and many others over the years, former students who developed all these levels of the constitutive modeling from Zhong Bo to Luciano Massado and Olivier Bertacchini. You see the list. Most of them have gone through this community. They have come here, they presented papers in the student paper competition, and they got their first interaction and understanding of smart structures by coming to this conference. And Jim Boyd and other collaborators who are now mostly in universities pursuing different areas have been instrumental in developing some of the early, especially early work on shape memory alloys in our group. Of course, the sponsors. And we are very fortunate, starting with Gary Anderson, to get support from the Air Force, Brian Sanders, DARPA, National Science Foundation, NASA, and corporations, especially Boeing, helping us not just with support for resources, but also with technical expertise that they provide to us and collaborations. The name of the group is Smartans, and you can see the correlation with Spartans. We're strong, masterful, alert, resourceful, and thorough. I made this up last night. Okay. This is a thermal image. Darren insisted that we took this. We just bought a new thermal camera, and this is a thermal image of the group. I'm still trying to analyze it. Some people have high brain power, some others hot. We work very hard, even if we have to go to the mountains of New Mexico to experience snow. We try to bridge the gap of knowledge. We are not afraid of facing the cliff. This is a summer school. We enjoy good food. This is at an annual retreat, sitting in a dining arrangement or standing for the international food competition. This is now a tradition. We do it at least once a year with food prepared by Smartans, tested and evaluated by the same members. We celebrate success. This is Greek dancing. And this is the future for me of SMH, the new generation. This is the son of Darren Hartle, and he's trying to become a Spartan as well. And we take our dreams and hopes to the top of the mountain. This is Olympus Mountain, where we brought the Texas A&M flag for the first time. I would like to thank you and end this with something that the students produced at Texas A&M. It is the kinetic art, the well of shaped memory alloys. Thank you so much.
Thank you for an outstanding talk. Appreciate it.
We don't have questions, I guess.
We don't have time for questions because we ran right to the end of the time and I need to introduce the next speaker. And I'll tell you what, if there is maybe one question from the audience, and I had about five, I'm gonna have to take them offline.
We can do it during the break.
Okay, we'll do it during the break, okay.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you so much. Okay.